Good morning. I thought we'd lost the minister there. And a warm welcome to you all, and to those watching the live streaming, and those listening later this afternoon on Radio North Angus. We also welcome any visitors we have worshipping with us today. We hope that you will find fellowship with us this morning, and we ask that you take a moment at the end of today's service and put your names and addresses in the visitor's book in the transept on my right. The deadline for articles for the next magazine, which is the summer issue covering June, July and August, is tomorrow, Monday the 15th of May. Please either email Myra or you can leave articles in the box provided in the vestibule. There will be an extraordinary meeting of the Kirk session at the Old and Abbey Church at 6:30 this Tuesday. Can you please let Chris or myself know if you have any problems accessing the documents that have been sent out in the email just at the end of the week there. Communion cards are available for elders in the anteroom to collect. There is additional paperwork to go out with these cards, but at the moment it is not available. We will distribute this to elders at the session meeting on Tuesday evening. So we've got a wee request. If you wouldn't mind holding back going out with your communion cards until you have received the necessary information to go out to the congregational members, and that would be greatly appreciated. Thanks to all who entertained us on Friday evening and provided refreshments at the In Harmonies concert. It was an excellent concert. Well done, Vicky and choir. Tonight is the turn of the Arbroath Male Voice Choir concert, and they are performing here tonight at the West Kirk at 7 p.m. and tickets are priced £10 and they are available at the door. The stated annual meeting will take place next Sunday, the 21st of May, at the end of the morning service. Next Sunday also, from 3:30 to 4:30, there will be a prayer event in the West Kirk as part of the Thy Kingdom Come initiative. Tea and coffee will be served, and there will be opportunities for quiet prayer, prayer stations and conversation. Thy Kingdom Come is a worldwide initiative between the celebrations of Ascension Day and Pentecost, and encourage us to pray for one another. We will be focusing on our towns, churches and the future. The Guild Strawberry Tea will be on Saturday, the 24th of June, 10 until 12 in the large hall. Tickets are priced £4 and they will be available after next Sunday service and on every Sunday thereafter. And finally, if you know of anyone who would benefit from receiving the church flowers or a pastoral call, then please complete the cards that are in the vestibule. Thank you.
Thank you, Audrey. Good morning, everybody. You can see what the theme of the service is today. The theme of the service is Christian Aid, but I'm sticking with the lectionary readings that we have been following throughout the last few weeks. And our call to worship this morning comes from Psalm 66. Transforming God, you have taken the world's darkness and recreated a world filled with the joy of light and hope. Restoring God, you've turned defeat into sudden victory and recreated a world filled with the joy of peace and shalom. Renewing God, we respond to your mighty deeds with songs of praise, with worship and thankful prayers, for you alone are God. And today we come to worship you. And we start by singing number 470 in the purple hymn books, with the words also on the screen, "For Jesus shall reign where'er the sun."
Thank you.
I'm very sorry, choir. I keep singing words that I know and not looking at the screen. And CH4 has changed so many words, I think they wonder what's happening up here. We come together in prayer at the start of our time of worship to ask God, through his Holy Spirit, to enter into this place and enter into our lives. And don't worry, I haven't forgotten. We're saying the Lord's Prayer towards the end of the service today. So let's pray together. Creator God, you have planted the seed of love in our hearts, our souls, and our minds. We long for the brightness of your presence, drawing ever closer to you and to one another. And so we join with your people at all times, in all places this day, to worship and to serve. We thank you for the world around us, a world where in the blossom on the trees, in the busyness of the fields, in the ever-lengthening days and the cycle of the seasons, we see the Creator's hand at work. At the start of this year's Christian Aid Week, as we look further afield to other countries, climates, and landscapes, we thank you for the incredible variety of that created world. Today, as we think about comfort, as we think about companionship and the presence of the Holy Spirit in our lives, we thank you again for the family of faith established after the life, death, and resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. We thank you for those with whom we've laughed, those with whom we have wept and shared our sorrows. We bless you for those we have served alongside, sharing together in a common task, for those who've shared our dreams and pursued our visions as partners in a common purpose. We thank you for those with whom we worship together today, for those with whom we pray together, for those in whose company we have listened to your voice and sought to see you face to face. As we give thanks for all those in different relationships with us, we ask that you would forgive us the times when we have wanted nothing but our own way, the times in those relationships when we've been intolerant, seeing only our point of view, the times when we've said things in the heat of the moment, which perhaps we now bitterly regret. Creator God, once again, you have planted the seed of love in our hearts, souls, and lives. As we draw near today, in the knowledge that your forgiveness waters the seed and nurtures us with the power of your Spirit, we ask that you would help each one of us to grow, to flourish, and to bear the fruit of your justice, now and forevermore. Amen. Okay, so today, hopefully, we're in for a first. This week is the start of Christian Aid Week, and as Callum shared with us when he was here a few weeks ago, can you remember perhaps what he said? And I said, I've never heard of them. I'm just going to let them sort out the video while I show you these. You do listen well. Pigeon Peas is right. Let me tell you that none of the farmers at Aberla and Camille knew that these were pigeon peas. They did say split peas, and Anyway, these are pigeon peas. And if it works well at Youth Club on Thursday, we might be treating you to some pigeon pea cookies next Sunday. I have to cook these and then grind them down, and we use them as the flour for the cookies. But as the film, which hopefully is going to work, will show you, this is Esther's story, and this is why Christian Aid are focusing on Malawi and on the crop of pigeon peas. Right, David?
Welcome,
you can take it away.
The warm heart of Africa. Stay tuned for your Christian Aid Week broadcast.
Rising food and energy prices are impacting millions across the world. Economists point to COVID, the war in Ukraine, and poor harvests as the cause.
And now, a short ad break. Bread prices up by 50% in just 3 months. Our tasty locally produced rolls could be the solution. Esther is here to... serving delicious rolls straight from a poor produced oven. No need to travel, our team will come to you. Esther's rolls are baked using flour made from locally grown pigeon peas. So there's no expensive fuel-related cost to our price. And no need for costly imported meat. Thanks to pigeon peas' awesome drought-resistant properties, everyone can enjoy them when other crops fail. But hurry, Esther's rolls are slapping like hot cakes. They are loved by adults and children alike. Esther's little grandson Nespo can't get enough. Your family will love them too. Next on Christian Aid Week TV, it's Esther's story. Give today and help more families have a better future. Visit CAB.org.
I don't know if you could all see the words up there, but I know the choir couldn't because I couldn't see them. So just to tell you what Esther was talking about in Chichewa, her husband died and left her with two daughters and two grandsons. And she explains, which I will talk more about in a few minutes, how the local church supported her initially when he died, and how she then became involved with the Nandolo Growers Association, who are supporting people like Esther and other families in Malawi to grow pigeon peas because they are a shorter growing crop. The season is shorter, so there's more success because maize, which has been their traditional crop, is being destroyed by cyclones like the recent cyclone Freddy, and the impact of climate change means that harvest after harvest is being ruined. So they're changing what they're growing. These are specifically hardy and drought resistant, and because they're a short crop, then they get, I think it's about 3 months, they get three or four harvests a year. The Farmers Association then helps them to sell them properly, not to, she calls them bandits, but people who are unscrupulous and just wanting to take the next bit of money from them. And therefore, she's able to pay for her daughter to have tools, to be a joiner, which is her ambition, and she's also able to pay for her grandsons to begin to go to school, because school in Malawi isn't free, which is part of what's on the Christian Aid envelopes this year. Another lady who's part of the same cooperative is seeking to build up her income so that she can send her older sons to college. So if you didn't see the words, that's in essence what the video describes. Now, she was speaking in Chichewa. The next hymn that we're going to sing is a short African chorus from Zimbabwe. Come all you people, come and praise your maker. However, I have also put up the African verse, Vicky. So, we're going to sing the other one first, David. But go on, put it back on. Put that one back on, that's fine. So, this is how you say it. Uaye Mose, tinamate mware. Uaye Mose, tinamate mware. Uaye Mose, tinamate mware. Uai Mose Zvino. It's very straightforward. Let's stand to sing hymn number 757. Thank you, Audrey. Felt like we were going back to Africa there. That was great. Okay, Linda, would you like to come and share our readings for us today as the young people go out to DJ Club? Thanks, Linda.
Our first reading this morning is from Psalm 66, reading from verse 8 to 20. That's page 575 in the Pew Bibles. Praise our God, all nations. Let your praise be heard. He has kept us alive and has not allowed us to fall. You have put us to the test, God. As silver is purified by fire, so you have tested us. You let us fall into a trap and placed heavy burdens on our backs. You let our enemies trample over us. We went through fire and flood, but now you have brought us to a place of safety. I will bring burnt offerings to your house. I will offer you what I promised. I will give you what I said I would when I was in trouble. I will offer sheep to be burnt on the altar. I will sacrifice bulls and goats, and the smoke will go up in the sky. Come and listen, all who honour God, and I will tell you what he has done for me. I cried to him for help. I praised him with songs. If I had ignored my sins, the Lord would not have listened to me. But God has indeed heard me. He has listened to my prayer. So I praise God, because he did not reject my prayer or keep back his constant love from me. The second reading is from John chapter 14, reading from verse 15. The promise of the Holy Spirit. If you love me, you will obey my commandments. I will ask the Father, and he will give you another helper who will stay with you forever. He is the Spirit who reveals the truth about God. The world cannot receive him because it cannot see him or know him. But you know him because he remains with you and is in you. When I go, you will not be left all alone. I will come back to you. In a little while, the world will see me no more, but you will see me. And because I live, you also will live. When that day comes, you will know that I am in my Father and that you are in me, just as I am in you. Whoever accepts my commandments and obeys them is the one who loves me. My Father will love whoever loves me. I too will love him and reveal myself to him. Amen.
Thank you, Linda, and thanks be to God for these readings from his holy word. We're going to sing again as we think about the presence of the Holy Spirit in our lives. We're going to sing CH4 189, Be Still for the Presence of the Lord.
Thank you.
Let's pray together. Holy God, whose power and presence and glory is reflected in your word, be with us this morning in the stillness as we meditate on your voice, on your Holy Spirit, on your presence in our lives. At the start of this Christian Aid Week, as we think about loss and love and your presence, be with each one of us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Okay, by popular demand, 2 weeks, maybe 3 weeks ago now, I'm losing count, it was our middle daughter Becca's wedding. There you go. It was a wonderful day. It was a day full of joy and of very few tears, actually. It was a very relaxed weekend altogether. And over the last 20 months, because that's the amount of time since they'd got engaged, the two of them have traveled up to Scotland a lot because they've had to make all the usual plans that there are for a wedding. They've had to hire kilts, buy a dress, sort a venue, caterers, cars, the rest goes on. And in particular, they did make time to make sure that the guests who were invited, and many of them came quite a distance, a couple from Africa, a couple from, two individuals, one from America, one from Canada, and plenty from London and other parts of the UK, they did make an effort to make sure that they were comfortable and catered for over the weekend. And as is the case with many couples these days, they then went on a mini moon for 5 days in a hut somewhere off the west coast. Last weekend they went back to London and the wedding bubble has well and truly burst because they've been back at work for a week now. The reason I tell you this, however, is that whenever Becca goes back to London, I'm emotional. I feel a sense of loss when she disappears back down the road, even though it's relatively straightforward to get down there, and with messages and with FaceTime, you can do that instantly. This time in particular, I felt it was very much like an ending, as they had trouble getting back because the flights were cancelled and eventually they went back on a train. I felt a little as if a part of me had gone with her. And perhaps that's with today's travel and the fact that our children live a long way away from where we might be, perhaps that's a feeling that many of you over the years have shared. In the Christian Aid film that we watched just a few minutes ago, going on to the next screen, David, Esther has also experienced a loss. Hers is a much starker loss than mine, in that she lost her husband. And in that loss, she lost not just the practical source of the family's income, but also her partner for life. Now, as Brits, I'm not sure that we're particularly good at expressing our emotions at loss. Now, that might be the loss of a loved one. It might be somebody who moves a distance. It might be the loss of a job. It might be the loss of a good neighbour who moves house after many years of being next door. In our lives, we suffer and endure all different kinds of losses. It is part of our life. How many times do you say to somebody, "How are you today?" and they just say, "Oh, I'm fine." And what does that really mean? You know, I mean, it might mean they're fine, but it might be just a way of saying, "I really don't want to talk about it" as well. We aren't awfully good at talking about these kinds of emotions. And yet, this is exactly the situation that Jesus' disciples are in this passage in John. It's also the kind of situation that the psalmist is in as he writes Psalm 68, having been through difficult times, times of loss and devastation. Jesus' disciples are in that upper room. They have shared the last, what we now call the Last Supper, with Jesus, and he is talking to them about going away. They don't really understand at this point in time exactly the means and exactly how that's going to happen, which isn't really a surprise. But they do get the point that in some shape or form, Jesus is going away, and there is going to be this loss, this sense of loss of the teacher, the leader, the person who they have been with for a considerable amount of time. And in these few short verses, Jesus seeks to comfort them. He seeks to reassure them, to sustain them. He starts off by saying that he loves them and that he cares about them. And that though he is going away, the Good News Bible says that he's going to send them another helper. The translation of the Greek is actually another of the same kind. Now that other that Jesus is talking about there is what we have come to know as the Holy Spirit. In the coming week, the church celebrates Ascension Day, and not next Sunday, but the Sunday after, we celebrate Pentecost, the coming of the Holy Spirit. And so perhaps in this post-Easter season, the introduction here in John's Gospel of the promise of the Holy Spirit is really appropriate and opportune for us, because it reminds us that though the resurrection is the pinnacle, if you like, of Jesus' ministry, for us as Jesus' followers, it's actually only the beginning. And it is the promise of the Holy Spirit in us, not somewhere distant, but actually in us and a part of our lives, that allows us to connect to Jesus and to God and to the family of faith around the world. Now, Colin Sinclair, an ex-moderator of the Church of Scotland, puts this a lot better than I do. But what Jesus is trying to describe is something that perhaps we can read on paper and understand, but struggle really to experience. It's a little bit of a paradox, so I'm going to quote what he says. Colin says that what Jesus is describing in this passage is that he will be absent physically, but actually present. That he will be hidden. We can't see him, we can't touch him, but yet he will be a presence. He will be dead, but yet he will be alive. And for the disciples and for us, that can be quite difficult to grasp, as can our place in God's family. For the disciples who've lost their leader, or who are about to lose their leader and their teacher, they're not going to be orphans, Colin says, but they're going to be adopted. They are going to belong. They might not belong within the Jewish community. They might not belong within their villages and towns. They might be expelled out of their synagogues as the Christian church begins to form. But they will belong, for God is their father, all of their fathers. They would be secure, because Jesus, through the Holy Spirit, would never leave them. And they would be loved. And loving, says Colin, leads to knowing. It's a wonderful promise, but sometimes it's difficult to see it working out in reality. And here's where Esther comes in Christian Aid. And that's because When Esther's husband died and she suffered these terrible feelings of loss and was bereft, every day different people from the church family and some of the church leaders came to visit her in her house. They came to visit her and they prayed with her. They didn't try to take her out of her house. They didn't try to do anything different with her. They just came and they prayed with her. And slowly by slowly, over time, the loss still remained, but she found a way to go on, to take each new day for what it was. Partly because he had said to her, "You must live for these grandchildren." And she says late on in the film that when they come to see her, she feels happy and renewed inside. And therefore she gets involved in the farmers cooperative and her life changes and they go on. But in her loss, the people of the community came to her. They walked alongside her and they prayed with her. Through them and through her own prayers, she experienced the power and the presence of the Holy Spirit. And it allowed her to still feel a part of the community, to still feel a part of the family of God, and to carry on with her life. So for us today, in the losses that we experience, as in this post-Easter season, we reflect on our losses and on the presence of the Holy Spirit in our lives. As we reflect on love and on Jesus' call for his disciples to love as they love themselves, then that offers us memories of what Jesus told us to do. And he told us to go out and to love one another just as Esther and her friends have done. And in this Christian Aid Week, it helps us to reflect on others in different parts of the world and how we can help them. For Jesus said, "Whatever you have done to my brothers and sisters in my name, then you have done to me." Amen. The next hymn that we're going to sing is very appropriate. It's a hymn that we often sing at communion, but the table doesn't have to be the communion table. We're going to stand to sing together hymn number, where am I? I've lost my page. It's up here, 685. "For everyone born a place at the table."
Thank you.
Let's pray together. Living God, you have given us life and breath and all that we have. We have nothing to give you except what we've received from you. Today, we bring you our offerings. Today, we bring you ourselves. Help us to dedicate to you all that we have, all that we have experienced, all that we have lost, and all that we are, so that you may have what is indeed your own. Fill us with a deep and abiding awareness of your presence, of your call and your grace in our lives, and shape us into the people you have made us to be. Reflecting on the assurance of Esther, who prayed at a time of great loss, confident in the power of prayer to change the world. Together we pray today for those who suffer loss in all its many forms. For those in Malawi affected by the impact of Cyclone Freddy. For countless families across the world whose lives and livelihoods shattered by natural disaster. We think of the earthquakes earlier in the year in Syria, the forest fires in Chile, and the flooding in Brazil. Bless those, good Lord, who are bowed down and brought low under the burdens they must carry. We thank you today for the work of international organizations like Christian Aid, who seek to support, to sustain and enable those suffering to go on, finding new ways of living, creating communities of care and aspirations for the future. We pray too for those whose loss is more personal, for friends and for family taken as a result of conflict, as part of the armed forces or simply caught in the crossfire. Thinking of the continuing violence in Sudan, the escalation on the Ukrainian border and in so many other parts of the world, we pray that you would bind up the brokenhearted and comfort those who mourn, husbands, wives, children, and more. We thank you for all those who seek peace and pray for wisdom for world leaders in their decisions, in their agreements and allegiances, that they would seek a different future. We pray for those whose losses mean that they are anxious and lonely, whether through age, through pressure of work or the lack of it, or by being strangers in a foreign land, separated by language and culture from familiar ways and much-loved customs. Help your church, loving God, we pray, to be a place of acceptance and belonging, a place of welcome and inclusion where all can find a home, a listening ear, a friendly smile, and a helping hand. In a moment of quiet, we bring our own prayers to you for all whose illness, grief or challenging situation lies on our hearts today. Let us turn to God in trust, to find comfort and strength in the presence of the Holy Spirit, the Spirit who guides us together when we pray, saying the prayer that Jesus taught his followers. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Our final hymn today is a great hymn of praise, number 622 in the Purple Hymn Books. We sing a love that sets all people free. Go now into the world, working together for change, so that everyone can thrive and share life in its fullness. And in all we do, let us show the love of Jesus, treating everyone with dignity, standing up for equality, and fighting for justice. And may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. And as you go, may the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and the same Holy Spirit rest and remain upon you this day and forevermore. Have a seat. The duty team will just open up the doors. If I don't see you at the male voice choir tonight or during the week, I hope you have a good week and that the sun continues to shine.